said everything up. Thanks to my students who I forced to come up with all the giving a speech tonight. And thanks especially to all the alumni who have come back to help you guys transition into the real world. What is it about Kenyon that makes alumni make movies about it? Why is it that so many of us marry each other? Why is it that after you graduate, you will chase after someone wearing a Kenyon t-shirt and race after someone whose car bears a Kenyon bumper sticker? When I was looking at colleges back in the day, the local library had an ancient copy of the Underground Guide to Colleges. It dated back to the 1960s and it referred to Kenyon as an oasis of turned on freaks in the American world. My boyfriend and brother told me that everyone he ever met with Monte Kenyon was an interesting person. And that turned out to be true, although it wasn't always the good kind of interesting. My first year here, I lived in Norton. There was a Viking-looking guy who lived in Lewis, played a flute in the quad, and proudly drove a hearse. There was a hippie girl we called Raccoon Eyes because of the excessive use of eyeliner, who chose to live nearby in a yurt. And she smelled like someone who lived in a yurt. And a timeless mix of patchouli and body odor. Kathy Sunday, who lived down the hall, was a chain smoker, who allowed her cigarettes to burn out while they stood upright on the floor. So over time, her room became both an obstacle course and a carcinogenic sculpture garden. They were the two best friends we called the Fish Sisters, because their names really were Greasy Salmon and Claire Bass. They were Southern Belles who had met at Miss Porter's School for Girls, which struck us as something out of Tennessee Williams. There was a ballet dancer and a Nigerian punk rocker and an arsonist who dressed like he was living in Paris in the 20s. Although it must be said we didn't find out about the arson until our 10th reunion. We were sometimes charmed and sometimes embarrassed by these people. But what my friends and I really cared about was not eccentricity, but talent. And we spent a lot of time talking about which one of us would make it big. I was here with a cresting wave of talented people who became my friends. One was Allison Jenny, and she has, by any measure, made it big. Another ended up a successful television writer and screenwriter whose credits include Mall Cop. One became an AIDS activist who stormed the CBS Evening News in the 80s with a group called ACT UP. One became a public relations consultant who advised politicians through scandals and crises. One became a fundraiser for the Joyce Foundation, married a lawyer, and lives in Winnetka. One died young of a heart attack. One miraculously survived brain cancer. And a few, including me, became writers and professors. So it's not as simple as making it big or failing outright. Perhaps you make it big, but in a way you didn't expect. Or you make it artistically, but not financially. Or financially, but not artistically. Or perhaps you make it, but in a way that only the people in your field know your name. Or you might decide that you don't really want to do the thing that brought you applause at Kenyon. It's one thing to get cast in vocal shows. It's another to weather the ups and downs of an actor's life. But when we talk about what we choose to do with our lives, don't we have to talk about what the end goal is? As it turns out, the goals we set for ourselves at 21, which often involve money and success, end up being beside the point. What we're after is happiness. You only have to look at the famous grad study, which followed 268 Harvard graduates over 75 years. They were a group of men that included John F. Kennedy and Ben Bradford from the Washington Post. The Atlantic magazine to explain that in an effort to determine what factors contribute most strongly to human flourishing, the study measured an astonishing range of psychological, anthropological, and physical traits, from personality type to IQ to drinking habits to family relationships to hanging length of, let's just say, genitalia. As it turns out, what matters most to our happiness is the warmth of our relationships and the sense of connection. It matters more than fame, more than money, more than success. And one of the things Kenyon can offer you over the course of a lifetime is the opportunity for connection. Perhaps your fellow students don't all seem interesting to you now, but you will soon realize that everyone in this room is interesting, largely because they are interested. When you return for reunions with divides that now seem so important, between one team and another, between independents and fraternity brothers, between the artsy-fartsy people and the pre-meds, will have melted away. And you will realize that what you have in common is a certain important chunk of your lives, a set of values, and this place that means so much to all of you. The first time you walk into a dormitory where you once lived, the smell will be like the taste of Proust's Madeleine. You'll suddenly remember ecstatic couplings, regrettable one-night stands, and being in bed with nothing but a Kenyon crud. You'll remember late-night pizza from the home, late-night shopping, leery-eyed studying with yellow highlighters and toilet flushes that turned your showers cold. After I graduated, I missed the certainty of the weekend's parties. I missed the encouragement of my professors. I missed the best parts of myself being used. But mostly, I miss my friends and the wit over dinner in the dining hall. Those of you who were forced to read my place in the baby drama may have guessed that's where salt and pepper theater began. For the invest was performed by two pepper shakers. Waiting for the dough was performed by two salt shakers. And those were the highbrow examples. We also used two salt and a pepper to perform the opening from the television show The Mod Squad. Because of those many meals together, Kenny and Moms learned the art of conversation and how to make someone laugh so hard that milk comes out of their nose. Although we now live in different places, my Kenyan friends and I continue to make each other laugh. Indeed, we rejoice in every egregious Facebook post from a certain fellow alum who shall remain nameless. He seems to be simultaneously writing a novel, sleeping with models, advising Congress, playing basketball with monks, staving off pleas to run for office, and drinking with rock stars. This Facebook offender is invariably frying fish with famous southern chefs and sending shout-outs to his beat poet homies. We made a virtual dining hall game of inventing titles for this man's autobiography. Should he ever find time to write it? Here are a few titles in the running. No thought too small. Thoughts I am thinking. And finally, me, me, and did I mention me? When we were students, the thought of attending a 10th or 25th or 50th reunion was beyond the pale. The eager to please drunken alum makes regular appearances in the plays the students write for my classes. That guy, and usually is a guy, is anxious to prove that he's still young, still cool, and can still hold his liquor. He can't. But tuck in some slack, he really was you not so long ago. And you don't have to be that kind of sad, backward-looking alum. Be the kind who comes back and shares what you've learned about life in the real world. Come back and tell the students what you wish you'd know when you were college seniors. I wish I'd known that becoming big is a process, that life is a marathon, not a race, I wish I'd known that other people don't let you enter a profession. You decide what you're going to be. Somebody's going to do it. Why shouldn't it be you? I wish I'd known not to move back home after graduation because living with your parents will feel like treading water. I wish I'd known to be happy with the body God gave me and had the courage to introduce myself to people. I wish I'd known to go to my friends' weddings even when I couldn't afford to. It wasn't until my friend got cancer that I realized that I couldn't let years pass between visits. I wish I'd known to make time for my parents. Because they have always been there, I assume they always be there. If I were going to recommend one book for you to put on your first IKEA bedside table, it would be an out-of-print book called Flow, which puts forth a simple equation. What you get back from anything is equal to the effort you put into it. You want to be a great writer? Write. You want to maintain lifelong friendships? Find the time to see each other. You want to be an interesting person? Keep your mind alive. As A.O. Scott recently wrote in the New York Times, the incentive is not to think, to be one of the many available varieties of stupid, are powerful. But there is also genius around us and within us. There is Hamilton and Pippa Butterfly, Transparent and the novels of Elena Ferrante. Take your pick. We need to put our remarkable minds to use and to pay our own experience the honor of taking it seriously. Don't stop reading. Don't stop looking at art. Don't stop having real conversations. Don't stop going to the theater, especially when they're producing one of my plays. The many people I know, both my contemporaries and my former students, have kept the best parts of who they were in college. They are as curious, as well-read, and as funny. This is a club you will be happy to be a member of. Thank you. Thank you.